Welcome to another episode of Wellness Curated. This is your host, Anshu Bahanda. And as you know, the aim of our podcast is to help you lead a healthier, happier, more hopeful life. And we do so by giving you ideas, trends, techniques, tools from all over the world. This season, we're focusing on environmental wellness. And today we're discussing a pressing global issue that's shaping the future of our planet, climate change. We have with us Dr. Marcus Watson. He's an esteemed expert and he has a passion for service, quality, and innovative solutions. He was CEO of Ground Control, a UK-based ground maintenance company. He's now non-executive director. He also invests in environmentally friendly projects, and he's going to bring us a wealth of knowledge and expertise and shed light on this important topic. Welcome to the chat, Marcus, and thank you for taking the time to be here with us today.
Well, it's an absolute pleasure to be here, and thank you so much for your kind introduction. I hope I live up to it.
Thank you. I'm sure you will. But Marcus, I'm going to jump right in and ask you, what inspired you to focus on environmental wellness and climate change in your career? Because I know you had another career, you used to fly one time.
It's an important question, because I think a lot of people are probably also like me, realizing that we're in a really tricky place when it comes to the double crisis of climate change, and affected by that in great part, the loss of biodiversity that is impacting the way that we are going to live happy, healthy lives in the future. And so those two things are huge crises, the likes of which we haven't seen ever in the length of humanity. And I have children, and I would love for my children to inherit a world that is at least as good as the one that I was born into, and hopefully better. That is the personal motivation for wanting to help those businesses and projects that do have the transition to net zero and living in a more sustainable way in harmony with nature. Though that is my personal motivation, and I'm optimistically hopeful that a greater number of people will see it as we do, and will join. We'll join this movement and be able to help it along and achieve the things that are so important for us to achieve in very short timescales.
That's exactly what my motivation is as well. Can you give us an overview of how businesses can be a force for good when it comes to climate change? And what are some of the pressing problems that you see related to climate change that businesses can actually help solve?
I think that business has an incredibly important part to play in the transition to net zero. And there are enormous opportunities, business opportunities in that transition as well. So by some estimates, there are the reallocation of capital that is required to transition to net zero is the largest reallocation of capital that the world has ever seen. And some estimates are $100 trillion, or there or thereabouts, to be able to affect that transition. Now, the reason why business has such an important role, because you'll hear oftentimes, the government, the world leaders need to do more, and of course they do. The pace of change that we need is perhaps hampered by the sometimes necessary slower pace of change of government and those who are able to affect at a macro level. So being an entrepreneur, being able to move quickly and to spot an opportunity to do good and actually create a good business out of it is something that business is very good and entrepreneurs are very good at doing. So if I look, for example, at the transition to a new source of energy, so a sustainable source of energy, whether that's wind or solar, battery storage, hydrogen to some extent, so long as it's green hydrogen, and this needs to be carefully considered, because hydrogen can actually be greenwashing if we're not careful. So there are so many opportunities in, for example, the production of energy. But there's also how we go about the use of energy. How efficient are we in our use? How do we change the automotive industry is a fabulous example of how they've transitioned from fossil fuels, or are transitioning from fossil fuel to battery storage in order to deliver a new kind of automotive industry. So I think there are two real key pressing reasons why business can be a force for good. One is the speed at which it can act. And the second one actually is that it makes good business sense to do so. There is an enormous amount of opportunity, just as, you know, imagine when the automobile was first conceived in the late 19th century, and that created an enormous amount of business opportunities, not just because of the vehicle, but all of the things such as motor insurance. I mean, motor insurance didn't exist in 1850, right? But those kind of opportunities are real, they're tangible, and they will continue to evolve until such a time as we reach that steady state of net zero and living in a sustainable way with nature. And in that transition, business is superb at innovating. It will try things, it will fail fast, and test different innovations to see what sticks, what works. And if it works and if it sticks, then do more of it, right?
Yes, absolutely. So tell me, how have you seen the conversation around climate change and business responsibility evolve in the last decade? Because there is a lot of talk at the moment about it.
You're absolutely right. And it has shifted enormously. And I'm part of that shift. A decade ago, I was not as educated on these matters. And I became more educated, much more interested. So the conversation for sure has shifted from always this thing for real, not really understanding the data, the information, the scientific background that supports the fact that we are facing two crises. That is much, much better understood. The basis of the conversation is, we have a problem, how do we solve it, versus do we really have a problem? So there is, of course, a voice out there that says, well, we don't really have a problem, do we? But it's much, much smaller than it was 10 years ago. And the volume of information and of educated businesses is far greater than it has been. And I believe it is also far greater than the deniers.
Okay. And how would you define purpose beyond profit? The concept that you've been talking about in the context of climate change and environmental wellness. And also give us some examples of how companies have effectively addressed climate change while also maintaining profitability.
I mean, let's first and foremost put to bed the fact that it costs money to be sustainable. It costs money to be green. We're doing this because it's an altruistic reason. That's just wrong. If we look at the amount of investment that's going into businesses that have green credentials and sustainability at the heart, and that purpose beyond profit, they receive more investment, are more profitable, and are more valuable than those companies that do not. And over time, those companies that are not sustainable will reduce in profitability, as consumers, the population, will vote with their feet. We will not wish to buy from companies that are harming the future of our children. So the purpose beyond profit is, you know, purpose beyond profit can be not just for climate change and sustainability, it can be for anything. And this is a personal belief, that if businesses wish to have the right to be in business and wish to have the right, the privilege, it's not a right, the privilege to be successful, then it has to give back to society. If the sole motivation of a business being is to make profit, I think there's a huge amount that is missing. And that amount is the community the links that it has with the communities that it serves, its people, its customers. And it would be like operating in a vacuum. And in my opinion, those types of businesses that don't have a purpose beyond profit, frankly, I question whether they have the right to be a successful business. You know, there needs to be. It can't just be take. It's got to be a two-way. Two-way equation here.
Right. And can you share some examples of companies that are doing, effectively addressing climate change and maintaining profitability?
Yeah. I mean, the business that I'm still a shareholder of and a director of is Ground Control. It's an amazing company. I am biased, by the way. but it's a company that, its purpose is to care for our environment and to ensure that humans and nature can cohabit well and happily. The way that Ground Control goes about it is actually investing in tech and people to help achieve the outcome of caring for the environment. And what we do, as you said earlier, we maintain the external space, we create landscapes, we manage vegetation, we plant trees and vegetation. But what's particularly interesting, and Ground Control's very profitable. What's particularly interesting in having caring for our environment at the forefront of our mind is that it drove us to make certain decisions that actually have proven to be financially very beneficial. So back in December 2019, I think it was. It was decided that actually from now on, we're not going to buy company cars that are diesel or petrol. You know, there are alternatives that are better for the environment. And therefore, we're going to only buy electric cars from now on for our fleet. Vans was going to take a little bit longer, but let's start, let's make the first step, which, by the way, in my view, is perhaps the most important. But then what we found is that we had range anxiety, and we thought, well, if we have range anxiety, well, our customers might do as well. So, hey, why don't we create a business that is about supplying and installing electric vehicle charge points for our customers? And that is a brand new business that, had caring for our environment not been the purpose of Ground Control, arguably we wouldn't have thought that this was an obvious thing for us to do. And of course it is. You dig a hole, you plant a tree. You dig a hole, you plant an electric vehicle charge point. With a few. And again, this is a new area of business. It's exciting. It's a growing market. It is profitable. And so that's one small example. Another company that didn't even exist had the transition to net zero not been so very critical. And this is a company called Xlinx. It's a very large British project. Fully funded and fully deployed, it will be about £20 billion worth of investment. And what Xlinx is about is recognizing that the provision of energy needs to shift away from fossil fuels and go to more sustainable ways. And the cheapest form of producing electricity, the cheapest way, bar none. So if you start with a blank sheet of paper and you don't have legacy infrastructure that is holding you back, it's solar power. And so my dear friend and the brain behind Xlinx is Simon Morrish. He founded the business on the basis that this was a sustainable and much more cost-effective way of generating electricity and switching away from fossil fuels in the process. So imagine now that this is a small entrepreneurial business with enormous ambition that has secured with the Moroccan government an agreement to generate electricity in Morocco through solar and wind and technology all combined, and deliver that energy to its customers, including the UK, mainly the UK to start with, through undersea cables to generate 8% of the UK's electricity, 8%, through 100% sustainable means at a price point which is actually really cost effective and attractive. The beauty of this is because of the location and the mix of technology, this is uncorrelated to the energy, for example, produced in the North Sea through wind farms. And therefore, this is valuable. It is all this energy also is predictable. It doesn't fluctuate to the same extent. It's baseload effective, I call it. It's not baseload, but it's effective baseload is another way of looking. So putting all of these things together, this is a really attractive solution to not just mitigating a very difficult climate change crisis. So it's 8% of the energy mix of the sixth largest economy in the world. But on top of that, it's a great business. This is a business that did not exist a few years ago. And with investment from partners such as Tacker and Octopus Energy, the project is continuing to progress. And some of the, if I may go on a little bit here, some of the consequential decisions of starting this project led us to have a look at, well, what's the availability, for example, of cabling to be able to connect Morocco to Great Britain? What is the availability of the engineering ships that are required to lay the cables, the cable laying vessels? And what Exlix found is that there is an insufficient supply across the world of both cable and cable laying vessels. And so another company was created to create two factories to make cables, and those cables will be sold to Exlix and anybody else who needs cabling. And we've also designed the world's largest cable laying vessel, which will again service not just Exlix, but will service other customers. So there are so many opportunities that start with purpose and deliver fantastic businesses.
Marcus, this brings me to a question that I've had very often when it comes to companies which are trying to do good and for climate change. You've put cables all the way from Morocco to Great Britain in this case. Is that more carbon efficient than generating the electricity in the UK?
Right. So there are some losses for sure. So the losses between Morocco and the UK will be, but they're slight because we're using, or Exlix is using HVDC technology. So the losses there have been modelled, and they're modelled to be, and I'm making this up from memory, so forgive me if I get the numbers slightly wrong, but it's roughly 10 to 15% or there or thereabouts. So when you consider that loss, and the loss is there because they're HVDC, are significantly lower than they would be on an AC network. And that's why the reason why we're creating an additional network here is one for capacity. You just need more electricity as you're shifting away from fossil fuels. Then you actually need the non-fossil fuel bit to be able to cater for that existing and continued demand. But the second reason is we needed an HVDC network in order to mitigate the losses and reduce the losses over those long distances. Now, all of this is well-known technology. It exists. There are already such projects, for example, in China, and there's another project that's linking Australia to Singapore in this way. So our view here is, well, let's use existing technology and apply it to a problem that needs a solution here.
But I have another question here. My question is, you've had to lay these cables. Mm-hmm. Look at the carbon efficiency of that. Was that still more carbon efficient?
Yeah,
creating the cables, laying them, than generating the electricity in the UK?
Immensely so. Yeah, absolutely, immensely so. So, and let's not forget that the infrastructure required to produce fossil fuel energy source is also requires an energy input, if you like. So it is measurably, of course. Everything can be measured, right? But it is much, much more efficient than not having it. So that's not something that is worrying us. It is so much more efficient to do it this way.
Okay. And as you know, with your experience as a CEO and as an investor, you talked about tech and people being some of the strategies that help integrate environmental considerations with business making, with business decision making. Can you give us some other practical strategies? And can you also share some of the challenges that businesses might face when they try and adopt a more environmentally friendly approach? Because you did say yourself that it is more expensive to try and be sustainable.
So, and forgive me if I've inadvertently given the wrong impression. I do not believe that it is more expensive to be sustainable. That perhaps might have been true some time ago, but the cost of doing business sustainably is so much more cost effective now than it ever has been, and will continue. And the prices of such technologies will come down continually as these technologies ramp up. And we've seen that, for example, in the automotive industry, where in the early days, if you wanted an electric car, then you needed to have pretty deep pockets. Whereas now it's becoming much more available to a wider audience, and will continue to do so. So one of the key challenges, however, is regulation and how the competitive landscape actually looks. So, for example, where it is, how you disincentivize, for example, to being green in the UK, when actually there is a way in which you can export, for example, your manufacturing to another country, where manufacturing might be subsidized in that country, and make it actually cheaper for that country to produce that manufactured item using old dirty technology. So there's a problem there in terms of regulation and making sure that there is a level playing field that enables green tech to compete at least on the same footing as dirtier technology. And in my view, actually, it should be completely the reverse, that where there is help, it needs to be directed at those technologies and businesses that do have sustainability as part of their business ethos, and they're not polluting the world. They are doing good in what they do. So regulations are a key challenge, and therefore as businesses, we need to engage with people who have the ability to consider such regulation and make them. And that's part of our responsibility as business entrepreneurs as well, is to have those conversations so that people are educated and are able to make good, informed, supportive decisions for the business community.
And coming to regulations and government, let's talk about the Paris Agreement. What can businesses do to help the global efforts to achieve the targets set in the Paris Agreement?
Okay. So the first thing to do is to join the movement, in my view, is become the leader that you want to see. Be the voice and be heard. Believe it and join that. That arguably is perhaps one of the most important things that businesses can do, is to decide, you know what, we are going to do this. We're going to investigate. We're going to get up to speed, and we're going to change for the better the way that we do things in order to be the sustainable business that we want to be. Now, part of that journey will require understanding, education, figuring out what your carbon footprint happens to be now. And there's help that you can get. There are consultancies and people. So, for example, the Carbon Trust is one such organization. Carbon Footprints, another carbon consultancy. These guys here, and there are plenty, will help businesses understand where they are now and what kind of initiatives will be helpful to get to a net zero position by 2050. And one of the things that I would encourage all businesses who are looking into this, what I would encourage them to do is to consider their plans on an SBTI, and that's a science-based target initiative. And the reason—
Sorry, can you repeat that, Marcus?
Yes, so it's a science-based target initiative, SBTI. So I would recommend that companies follow that methodology, if you like, because it is, I mean, it's pretty stringent, and it will push companies to consider very practically and in a measured way how they're going to reduce their carbon footprint from where it is today to zero. And it will require milestones, and it will require some quantitative steps to be able to achieve that. And these plans will be signed off by the likes of Carbon Trust, for example. Without having the SBTI, you could be accused as a business of perhaps greenwashing. So if you say we're going to be net zero by 2040 and our plans are very good and here they are, but they haven't been, if you like, audited or reviewed against the SBTI standard, then that makes that may make you look like you're greenwashing a little bit because you don't know what you're doing. So that's not to say that having a plan that is not backed by SBTI is not relevant, but it is just less strong. So I would recommend that. And then having got the plan, just do it. So it's, you know, like any strategy, plan, do, that's it.
That's it.
There is a bit of review in there to make sure, of course, that your plans are on the right track. So I would certainly recommend those as key initial steps businesses to take. And of course, within the plan, you can put anything in there, right? So whether it's carbon reduction or a new business stream and the like.
So Marcus, what about carbon credits? What are your thoughts on carbon offsetting as a tool for businesses to reduce their impact on climate change?
So carbon credits are very useful, and it's a very useful way to offset those emissions that you simply can't remove at the point of source. A preference is always, of course, not to reduce the carbon emission in the first place, but where you simply cannot, or the technology is not there yet, or you are on a journey on your SBTI net zero plan, then you might be left, and you will be left, and as a grant control has, an element of carbon emissions that you need to offset. And therefore, offsetting is a way of mitigating that emission which you have. Now, it's important, though, that should be, in my view, it should be not a primary solution. It should be something that you use where other options to remove carbon from the atmosphere are not there yet or not viable. And also how you choose those carbon credits is going to be pretty important. So what in reality are you buying, and what are people going to do with that money that you've ineffectively invested in an offset project? And some carbon offset projects are more robust than others. So there's VCS, for example, that's gold standard as well, which appear to have a higher standard than many, and therefore, you know, choose wisely which carbon credits you're going to be purchasing in that way. Now, and carbon credits do have, you know, some people are saying this should be absolutely part of the economy and will be where it is more cost effective to offset than to remove carbon at source, then we should be doing that. And others are saying offsetting is just the least bad of a bad bunch of options. Therefore, we shouldn't really do it. We should really focus all of our effort in avoiding the emissions in the first place.
What can you explain exactly what carbon credits are?
Right, so carbon credit is a way in which companies will pay for somebody else to remove carbon from the world in a different area. So if you're flying a lot, and you know, flying is actually a big generator of carbon, then companies will say, well, in order to offset these X tons of carbon, I'm going to buy credits from companies that will, for example, plant trees, that will, for example, invest in transitioning stoves, wood-burning stoves, to more efficient types of stoves in other parts of the world. So
it's not just planting trees, as a lot of people understand it to be. It could be other things as well, carbon offsetting.
Absolutely. So if for example, I mean, here's another one, for example, that there's a company that I've been helping. It's a company called DB Energy. So the founder there, Steve Sharratt, a friend, and his company does is to take food waste from hospitals, schools, councils, and that food waste is delivered to a waste-to-energy plant. And what that plant does is it processes the food waste. It creates a kind of soup, feeds it to a bunch of bugs. The bugs create methane. The methane is then captured refined and purified, and it's then inserted into the grid where it can be used, and it is used to replace fossil fuels. So this is, you're taking food waste, which would generate methane anyway. Methane is, as you know, a greenhouse gas, and it's much more potent than carbon dioxide. Therefore, having methane escape into the atmosphere is actually more damaging than carbon dioxide. So being able to capture that methane that would otherwise create more damage and be able to use it instead of methane, natural gas, to heat our homes is a good way of achieving a sustainable energy source. Now, that company there happens to be able to offer carbon credits to the customers. And there are, as I said before, there are carbon credits and carbon credits. Some are more valuable than others, and or more robust than others. And therefore, of course, ticking the box, please offset my flight, is a good thing to do. What I tend to do as well, one is I don't like flying, so I reduce flying as much as I can. And technology like this, by the way, Anshu, I mean, it allows us to have great conversations without having necessarily to meet in person. And therefore, this is a much more carbon effective way of us
Absolutely.
Having a superbly important conversation. So the first thing that I
would do... So technology, Marcus, that's a very good point. We talked a little bit about innovation and technology. You talked about electric cars a little bit. But tell me about innovation and technology in combating climate change. Are there exciting developments that maybe we wouldn't have heard of that will surprise us all? Let's talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, okay. So a lot of the technology that I'm involved with is technology that already exists and is actually mature. So the and if I go back to my dear friend Simon, who created X-Links, who founded X-Links, he was very clear. We're going to use existing technology such that we can deploy it quickly at a lower risk. So the innovation sometimes, the technology innovation, is not about the R&D and finding something new and a miracle cure or silver bullet to be able to solve this. It's actually the innovation comes by bringing together existing technology to solve the current problem in an innovative way. And so so that I think is important. I mean, if you look at DBE Energy as well, a lot of that technology is well known. It is you know, the bacteria, the biology is known. The bugs that are creating the methane by ingesting the food waste, that technology is known. The pipes, the pumps, the processing, all of that is known. The control systems, again, all of that is known. So therefore, that combination of existing technology and know-how to solving a current problem is also, in my view, an important way to look at things, because you're not hoping for a breakthrough, a silver bullet, to save us and find a solution here. Many of the technologies are already in existence, and we just need to apply them, perhaps to a new situation.
Right. And what role do you think businesses should play in educating people about environmental wellness and about climate change?
Yeah, to the very same extent that they're engaged in it, I think it's important through things like this. I mean, I thoroughly appreciate you giving me the platform to be able to speak about a topic which is super important to me and important to the businesses that I've invested in or work with. It is also possible, and I would recommend that all businesses do this, is when they're talking to their employees, they do so in a way that helps them also be mindful of climate change and sustainability and biodiversity loss in their own personal lives as well. So to give you an example, in ground control, when we decided that company cars were going to be electric, one of the things, and at the time, the company cars that we selected, there were Tesla cars. They were a little bit more expensive than to purchase, but the payback was going to work out quite nicely. Now, when we started to talk to our employees about this, they were obviously very excited to be receiving a new car that, you know, their kids would think, "Dad's cool now. You know, please can you drop me off at school? I would like my friends to see you drop me off in this nice car." what we decided to do as well is offer that benefit to the families of our employees, and our employees could, through a salary sacrifice, actually buy a second car for their partner, their children, whatever. So we didn't make the delineation that the air that we breathe in business and the air that we breathe in our homes is different. We did not believe that to be the case. Therefore, why wouldn't we have those kind of conversations with our colleagues, our employees, our friends in the same way, and encourage them through, for example, so when we said you can actually through sacrifice get an electric car. One of the things that we were clear on is that you needed to demonstrate that the electricity that you had at home to recharge your car was 100% sustainable. And therefore, we wanted to see a certificate, if you like, that you were not using a fossil fuel tariff, but you were using a sustainable tariff. So again, some people say, well, isn't that interfering with people's lives? And no, we're actually educating and we're showing that there are alternatives that are cost effective and that are beneficial for the planet as well. So that's an example of engagement. Another one is Ground Control created a thing called Green Games Live. So imagine a festival where we bring like-minded people together, our customers, our employees, figures in industry and government, charities. We bring everybody together and we create a conversation and an excitement around these two pressing issues and how we can help solve it, not just as business, but as stakeholders of the businesses that we represent.
There are three pillars that can affect climate change, and they need to collaborate and work together. And that's businesses, governments, and NGOs. But very often they're at loggerheads because each one has a different agenda. How do you think that problem can be solved?
I'm not sure that there isn't much overlap between business, government, and NGOs. I think there is enormous overlap in the interests of these three types of organization to work together. The differentiation that I would make is that there are organizations that are perhaps deniers of climate change and organizations that aren't. And in each one of those, business, NGOs, and government, there are those two camps. My sense is that the camp that says this is a real problem that we need to address is growing by the day and continues to do so, and I hope will continue to do so rapidly in the very near future. And then the other group is we get it, we need to get on and do something about it. So I think there's much more that brings people together than separates us. And the job of business, government, and NGOs that do see that there's a problem and that we need to solve it with much speed, they need to engage with those who disagree with that view. Now there are also, of course, we see this play out that we can't switch off one technology and immediately switch on another one. It takes time to do so. So that is perhaps where the differences, even in the camps that do believe that there's an issue and we need to do something about it, the speed at which we do that is an area of debate. I get, for example, that government has got many plates that it needs to keep spinning in order to maintain civil society, and that creates a rub, particularly when certain governments are just dragging their heels a little bit. And it's wonderful that NGOs and one of my heroes is Greta Thunberg, which is absolutely wonderful.
We do a rapid fire round at the end of each conversation to summarize what we've said. Marcus, one reason for businesses to work towards a sustainable business model?
A key reason for businesses to go to a sustainable business model is that your business will be irrelevant and die if you don't do so.
One important way businesses can contribute to achieve the target set by the Paris Agreement.
Start by knowing your baseline. Do so quickly. Engage with friends. Understand your baseline and create a plan that gets you from where you are today to net zero, preferably using SBTI, science-based target initiative targets.
Lovely. And Simon, I want you to leave people with one thing that everyone can do.
One thing
to help climate change.
Yeah.
Businesses, individuals, schools, universities, everybody, one thing.
So the one thing that people and businesses can do, I would say, is review all of your areas of activity and pick out the ones where you have a significant carbon footprint and just dial those down or replace them. So for example, here would be, did we need to meet face-to-face or could we conduct this via Zoom? And actually, this is really effective and it's reduced our carbon footprint of this conversation.
Thank you. And thank you so much, Marcus, for being here with us today. And to my listeners, that was Dr. Marcus Watson, who shared many, many powerful insights that will help change your life for the better.
Fabulous. It's an absolute pleasure to be here. Thank you so much for giving me the platform to share some ideas.
To my listeners, thank you for listening in today. We hope you learned something new and that we brought you a little closer to leading a healthier and happier life. If you enjoyed the conversation, please press like and please invite your friends and families to subscribe to my channel. And I would love to hear from you. So let me know any topic suggestions or any questions that you have. My email address is anshu@wellnesscurated.life. I repeat, anshu@wellnesscurated.life. Thank you for being here today and see you next week.